Everybody. My name is Johan Norberg. I'm a visiting scholar here at Columbia. And I'm honored to be chairing this panel with three very distinguished experts on the Russian military in the Arctic. We will have three different perspectives, a more general and contextualizing presentation by Dr. Lincoln Flake from the U.S. National Intelligence University. He has a long list of merits, but an important one is that he has been advising NATO on Arctic issues for more than 7 years. Then Anton Lavrov from CAST, the Center for Analysis and Strategic and Technology in Moscow, will be more into the details of the Russian military activities in the Arctic. For those of you who do not know the CAST Center in Moscow, for us in the analysis business of the Russian military, what they produce is a must read. Very good production indeed. Finally, we will have a more on the ground or from the ground perspective from the U.S. Coast Guard expert, Dr. Rebecca Pincus, an own expert on these issues. And I think there will be three very valuable perspectives into the discussion we can have after that. So without further ado, Lincoln first, please.
Okay. Excellent. Thank you very much for that introduction. Grateful for the invite to this very well-organized conference. Because I work for the U.S. government, I have to begin my presentation with a disclaimer that my opinions are my own and do not represent those of the National Intelligence University, the Department of Defense, or the U.S. government. Okay, with that out of the way, we can begin. As was discussed earlier this morning, the narrative of a looming Arctic confrontation is still very pronounced in some media, at some media outlets and some security circles. And Russian behavior of late has done very little to disabuse people of this concern. The impressive construction of security infrastructure along its Arctic coastline, as well as the greater tempo in military operations, deployments, and exercises in the Arctic are not especially reassuring. At the same time, Moscow's recent use of military force to negate a loss of influence in Ukraine and now in Syria certainly does not bode well for Arctic security. Part of the problem is that the Arctic is often viewed in the media and other areas as being structurally built for geopolitical tension. The home, as we know, is the region, as we know, is home to numerous unresolved disputes, a somewhat ill-defined legal framework, largely untapped hydrocarbon and transportation opportunities, and dramatic climate change. And the prediction of seasonal ice-free waters is often viewed as essentially fueling competition among the Arctic nations. The region's security configuration does not help things either, with an increasingly pugilistic Russia pitted against the other four Arctic Rim states, all of which are founding members of NATO. Fortunately, this broad stroke depiction of the security situation in the Arctic does not hold up very well against closer examination. It misses key mitigating elements, such as the considerable circumpolar cooperation of recent years and the abundance of very resolvable disputes. It also relies heavily upon this notion of Russia militarizing its Arctic coastline. It's this last point that I would like to discuss in depth today, because I believe if we can place Russia's intensified military activity in the Arctic in the proper perspective, the situation in the future appears a bit more sanguine. In order to contextualize Russia's military moves in the Arctic, allow me to provide today five or six sub-contexts. And my intention is not to gloss over what Russia is doing or to downplay what Russia is doing, but to provide a bit of perspective on what we've seen in the Arctic over the last 3 years. First, when we're talking about Russia's Arctic activity and military buildup, I think it's important to understand the historical context, specifically the ebb and flow of Russia's military presence in the region since the 1970s. We know that in the late Soviet era, a great increase of capacity was given to the Northern Fleet, especially in the Kola-Murmansk area. The fleet received the bulk of late Soviet naval deliveries, and by 1981, approximately 57% of all Soviet submarines and half of the strategic submarines were stationed in the north. By the end of the 1980s, the strike power of the Northern Fleet was estimated to be nearly as great as the other three fleets combined. Likewise, increases occurred in aviation, non-strategic naval capacity, and surveillance coverage. However, the pendulum swung quickly in the opposite direction in the 1990s and in the early 2000s. With the Arctic no longer a strategic priority, the Northern Fleet was left to decay, and the entire infrastructure, security infrastructure along the Arctic coastline, outside of the Kola Peninsula, was practically abandoned. It's important to remember that it is from this low point, this low baseline, that improvements have occurred since 2012, including the ongoing restoration of over a dozen air posts, the strengthening of air grouping and air defense, and the formation of two Arctic brigades, all under a newly formed command structure, the Arctic OSK, Operational Strategic Command. While these developments of late are certainly striking and demonstrate significant political resolve, they're best viewed in the historical context at this point as a correction rather than a wholesale militarization of the Arctic or a like-for-like restoration of a Soviet-era force structure. In connection with this historical perspective, it's also useful to place security enhancements in the Arctic within the framework of Russia's overall military reform and modernization effort. In 2008, Russia embarked on the most ambitious and successful reform or reorganization and equipment modernization program in the post-Soviet era. The Arctic is but one geographic component of this program. The final and most costly part of the program is the ongoing rearmament that calls for over $700 billion to achieve 70 to 100% new equipment by 2020. If one views Russian military upgrades in the Arctic in isolation, the pace and scope appears rather alarming, as if preparing for some unavoidable conflict. But when viewed against the backdrop of wider military upgrades, the developments are less startling for the Arctic as a region, with capabilities elevating roughly in line with the other strategic directions. A case in point is the recent announcement of three new Arctic, Army divisions to be stationed on the western border with NATO. And this illustrates the point that military improvements are occurring across the country. Now, the Arctic may be receiving a slightly higher proportion of resources, but this is likely due to the region having been so neglected in previous decades. The third context is an understanding of strategic tasking of the Arctic forces. Not all increases in military capabilities in the region are Arctic-centric. In fact, the mission of the Northern Fleet during the Soviet Union was not primarily to achieve naval superiority in the Arctic, but to maintain unobstructive access to the Atlantic and as a viable nuclear deterrence. The fleet's mission has begun to change to include Arctic patrols and show of force demonstrations. This mission change has been reflected in the revised 2015 maritime doctrine and is also reflected in recent statements by fleet commanders. And undoubtedly, as the ice melts even more, the reorientation of fleet activities towards the Arctic will increase. However, one should be wary of drawing direct correlation, equating the arrival of new vessels on the Kola Peninsula as some type of ominous sign for the Arctic. As was discussed earlier this morning, climate change is also an important context to Russia's security upgrades. As we know, ice reduction trends along Russia's Arctic coastline are much more pronounced than among the other Arctic rim states, and have compelled Moscow to accept that its previously ice-protected border will eventually open up to greater human activity. Consequently, the enhancement of border and law enforcement capabilities appear to be practical steps, especially in light of Russia's massive Arctic population, territory, and economic potential. This point is also highlighted by a quick look at strategic documents on the Arctic, which have changed from a focus on military confrontation to economic development. Early Putin-era policy papers were replete with Cold War concepts of strategic balance, zero-sum competition in the Arctic. Yet these papers had little or no bearing on Russia's actual security posture in the Arctic, which hardly changed. In contrast, strategic documents in 2008 and 2009, as well as more recent iterations, only have passing allusions to circumpolar balance of forces and military threats in the Arctic. Instead, these center on economic development and addressing human activity, including terrorism, illegal immigration, and smuggling. The strategic vision laid out in these more recent documents have witnessed remarkable follow-through, with security upgrades, military reorganization, equipment deployment, and legal reforms largely being crafted, not as preparation for military conflict, but to support the two main goals that were talked about this earlier today, and that is to create the Arctic as a national strategic resource base and the NSR as an international maritime navigational passage. The final and most, I think, discernible element of Russia's strategic intent in the Arctic is the actual composition of the changing force structure. Apart from the two Arctic brigades, which themselves are partially repackaged from existing units, Moscow has not moved in large-scale troop formations into the Arctic. The dozen or so bases that are being refurbished along the coastline are not full-fledged military bases, but multi-purpose posts with surveillance, border, police, and search and rescue functions, as well as space for temporary subunit-level military deployment. While military exercises do temporarily bring real combat capabilities into Russia's Arctic archipelago, the bulk of security infrastructure upgrades appear to intended to, one, monitor movement in the region, two, deter intruders, and three, demonstrate presence, rather than establish a vigorous offensive military capability. We see this emphasis on a denial of access characteristic of Russia's posturing in the Arctic through recent deployments there. Here I'm talking about the deployment of the S-300 anti-air system to Novaya Zemlya, which illustrates this protective posturing, as well as I have here five or six different deployments that have occurred over the last 12 months that certainly reinforce this idea of monitoring and deterring intruders. Taken together, these five or six contextual factors do not minimize Russia's military activities or downplay their relevance to changing the force structure in the region, but they should give us pause when considering Kremlin motives and conflict potential in the Arctic. Finally, I don't want to end on too optimistic and rosy of a prediction for the Arctic, so I need to mention one or two things that could inflame the situation, and here these are definitely on the horizon, but one issue when we're looking at Russia and potential triggers for conflict is Russia's aversion to NATO involvement in the region. Russian officials have emphatically rejected the need for NATO presence in the Arctic, likely concerned that the ice-free Arctic will attract NATO warships into the Arctic basin and into its EEZ. The appearance of a Russia-NATO rivalry in the Arctic may change for the worse Moscow's security posturing in the Arctic. There's also the lingering issue of Russia's extra-jurisdictional claims, maritime claims, and the invocation of Article 234 of UNCLOS. The Soviet Union made sure one paragraph, the so-called ice-covered provision, was included in the 1982 agreement in order to secure in international law its long-held claims on certain Arctic areas. Although based on environmental necessity with a non-discrimination clause, Russia relies on the provision to buttress its Arctic jurisdictional claim over all surface traffic along the NSR. This claim may well prove a center of gravity for tension in the Arctic, especially if the U.S. decides to test Russia's resolve with a freedom of navigation voyage. Finally, I'd like to conclude by saying, notwithstanding all these issues, Russian officials have endeavored to keep the Arctic separate from the larger deterioration of relations with the West since the 2014 Crimea annexation. This is evident in many statements from Russian representatives in the Arctic Council, as well as in the National Security Strategy 2015 that was released this past December, where Russia listed a litany of criticisms against the U.S. and NATO, but suspiciously left out the Arctic. And the Arctic was only mentioned three times, and two of those times it was mentioned in the context of cooperation and peaceful coexistence. This gets back to the question that was asked after the last panel, and that is sometimes it's difficult to discern Russia's Arctic approach from the mayhem that it's creating in Ukraine, in Syria, in the larger international domain. But especially in Russia, there seems to be a concerted effort to isolate, to ring fence, if you will, the Arctic from the tumult of the international larger international affairs. The concern moving forward is that in spite of cooperative efforts and seemingly resolvable disputes, attempts to isolate Arctic affairs from developments external to the region will eventually fail. I'm told I'm out of time, but I was going to list five or six U.S. policies or approaches that would help ameliorate tensions in the Arctic. One of these is just quickly is the U.S. would be wise to compartmentalize issues rather than amalgamating the region as a single geopolitical issue to be solved. In many ways, the U.S. is already doing this in the Arctic Council and the IMO, but there are other areas in the soft and hard security realms that that the U.S. could certainly engage with the Russia even more. And we've seen the Arctic Council, the Arctic Coast Guard Forum that was mentioned earlier, the reactivation of Russian participation in the annual meeting of the Arctic Chiefs of Defense and the Arctic Security Forces Roundtable would build trust and provide mechanisms for dialogue. With that, I'll close.
Okay, thank you very much, Lincoln, for a very, very good introduction. Excellent indeed. So we move on. I think we need the presentation again. With Anton about Russian military activities in the Arctic.
In the last few years, we have an increased Russian military activity across vast regions of Russian Arctic, from border with Finland to border with the United States. Here's a map of current military infrastructure development. Airfields reconstruction underway, new bases under construction, and new Arctic military units under formation. After major post-Soviet decline, all this new activity may be looking pretty formidable and unexpected. It's true that Russia doesn't not have new direct military threats in Arctic in short and mid-term to explain such a build-up, but there is another one. I will not go too far about what Arctic means for Russia. It was discussed in other panels. But of course, there is a direct defense interest too. Most of the Russian nuclear missile submarines have their designated launch position in Arctic. Those positions must be defended to safeguard nuclear deterrence capability. And NATO brass general can sleep restfully if he can, 1,000 miles wide gap of uncontrolled airspace on border, facing an all powerful rival. Fear of surprise disarming strike from this side by the United States still surprisingly strong with veterans of Cold War. So when long period of high oil price made possible much more investments in military infrastructure countrywide, Arctic fortification became one of priorities of huge new look military reform. Just in a few years, we have a radical change of stance. Published in the year 2008, a strategic policy document on Arctic didn't include a military build-up in region. The government wanted to improve the border guards and coast guards in Arctic, but was not planning to set up new military bases. 5 years later, military development in Arctic became a major point in next key strategic document on Arctic. Almost immediately, Defense Minister Sergei Shoigu announced concrete steps to boost military forces in Arctic region and to create several new military bases there. And in year 2014, in Russian national defense doctrine, Arctic was a major point again. To coordinate all new military activity in Arctic was established the Northern Joint Strategic Command, a new independent military entity for Russia. The Northern Fleet became the core of the new strategic command since it already has a wealth of experience of working in the harsh Arctic conditions. All non-Navy military units in Arctic was subordinated to Fleet's headquarters. Strategic Command directly subordinated to National Defense Center in Moscow and is not a part of any military district. In new status, Northern Fleet will not undergo any major restructuring or bolstering its ship number, apart from current rearmament plans announced before this new Arctic fortification. The biggest change will include the establishment of a new unit of patrol ships with reinforced hulls to operate off the Russian Arctic coastline and provide support to the border service, and to reinforce air group of single Russian aircraft carrier. Just 2 months ago was formed 2nd Shipborne Fighter Regiment with new MiG-29 CAF fighters. Additional economic and military activity in Arctic raised need for more icebreakers. Last year, Russian Ministry of Defense ordered 4 new major icebreakers. It's a first such order from military for at least last 3 decades. Such ships will be non-nuclear, but able to operate all along Russian Arctic coast. Military operation also can be supported by powerful icebreaker fleet of state-run company Atom Flot. Recently, company ordered 2 world's most powerful nuclear icebreakers, capable to operate in ice fields up to 3 meters thick. New contracts will guarantee that in foreseeable future, Russia still be an undisputed world leader in major icebreakers. In new role of Joint Strategic Command, Northern Fleet must provide coastal defense and control an inter-Arctic region, including the border with Scandinavia. This fleet single naval infantry brigade, this task was impossible. In year 2012, fleet was reinforced by a motor rifle brigade transferred from ground forces. Additionally, near the border with Finland, in Alakurti town was formed a new motor rifle brigade. For cost reduction, brigade will use infrastructure of the former post-Soviet bases here. It's a light motor rifle brigade without tanks, with light self-propelled guns and lightly armored rocket personnel carriers. Such structure make it more mobile in Arctic environment and allow easy transportation. On exercises, units of brigade already was temporarily deployed on Arctic island and coast. Second new Arctic motor rifle brigade planned to be formed in Yamal Peninsula was by the end of this year. It's a resource-rich but very remote region of Russia, 1,000 miles from nearest border, ground border. This placement is somewhat a surprise even in Russia. In contrast to Alakurti, all infrastructure for such a big military unit must be built from the scratch. It will be much costlier and require more time. But as of today, there is still no news about start of brigade formation and even about place where it will be formed. It's probable that plans were silently suspended. There are now plans to restore strong military presence in Chukotka Peninsula near the border with Alaska, where in Soviet times was based motor rifle division. From year 2014 onwards, Russian airborne troops joined a regular exercise in Arctic, including a company and battalion-sized paradrops on island and ice fields during winter. There are now plans to permanently station airborne troops in Arctic, but they can be used for as a quickly action forces. Given the low troop density in Arctic territories, even a small but capable and mobile force can make a difference there. New Arctic units receive special equipments unseen in the Russian military in more hospitable regions, including articulated rocket vehicles, military snowmobiles, and quads. Russian helicopters corporation just a few months ago certified a special Arctic version of military mil-age medium transport helicopter, widely used in region for military and commercial duties. New version has much more advanced avionic package than standard mil-age and even better adopted for use in extreme cold. For restoring radar coverage along vast Arctic coast of Russia and ensuring better control of Arctic islands, currently under construction 3 major military bases of Tricolor project. They offer a big improvement to Soviet standards thanks to experience from Russian Antarctic science bases and new Arctic border guard bases. Using a modern modular design, they will be fully autonomous. Airbase can host up to 500 personnel with relative comfort without having them to venture outside too often. To protect delicate military equipment from elements, there's hangars, something unseen in Soviet times. To ensure stable morale in such an hospitable place, even with better living conditions, base personnel will be rotated every 4 to 6 months. Along the northern Russia coast, also restored 5 smaller bases with less than 100 personnel each. Most of them little more than a radar early warning and military aviation direction posts. such as on Island Sredny and Wrangele and Cape Schmidt. Last year, December, in the latest Russian Arctic Novaya Zemlya Archipelago, was established first and only full-size combat unit on islands. It's a new anti-aircraft regiment of SA-20 long-range missiles. Regiment received pretty dated equipment from one of the Moscow units, which was rearmed recently with new SA-21 missiles. New regiment became a part of 1st Air Defense Division of 45th Aviation and Air Defense Army, which covers Kola Peninsula and main bases of Northern Fleet. Air defense units on other Arctic islands subordinated to the same division. 99th Tactical Group of Northern Fleet was formed on Katelny Island of Novosibirsk Archipelago in year 2014. It's a mixed group with small detachments from different combat units of Northern Fleet, including air radar, communication station, battery of short to medium range air defense, and even anti-ship coastal missile battery. Apart from radar coverage, military significance of this remote base is purely symbolical. Partially, it's a result of limited land space, which doesn't allow more personnel to be permanently deployed. Third similar base will be completed by the end of this year on Zemlya Alexander, the island of Zemlya, Franz Josef Archipelago. This most northern base doesn't have anti-ship missiles and used for air defense only. Base will host an early warning radar company, aviation direction post, and battalion of short to medium range anti-aircraft system for self-defense. Total personnel strength of this base will be less than 200 officer concurrent soldier in total. Current Arctic continental airfield restoration is a part of a bigger plan to repair all Ministry of Defense airfields and doesn't directly connect it with increased Arctic activity. Additionally, airfields Vorkuta and other TXC is dual use and shared by Ministry of Defense and civil users, and is vital for connecting northern regions with the rest of Russia. So it's believed that military investment will benefit civil population there as well. Nevertheless, after modernization, the military value and ability of force projection on entire region will improve too. Long paved runways can be used as forward operation bases for any military aircraft, tactical and strategic alike. After restoration, in TXC will be stationed at least one squadron of MiG-31 interceptors. Excluding Novaya Zemlya, Island airfields are basic and powered airstrips and have much less military value. They were restored and enlarged as part of base building project to allow operation of transport aircraft. And of course, it will be later used as for search and rescue duties. There's no plan to and infrastructure capability to use them as forward operation bases or station fighters. Early plans for station MiG-31 interceptors on Novaya Zemlya was abandoned because of huge needed investment to reanimate this entire field and to maintain their permanent aircraft presence. The decision to step up Russian military presence in Arctic was taken before an outbreak of this ongoing deepest crisis in Russian relations with the West and NATO, after Ukraine conflict and Russian military intervention in Syria. Changes in Russian military priorities and its defense doctrine resulting from those pivotal events may well affect the Arctic program, which is not regarded as urgent anymore. Official sources stressed that Arctic fortification is still a priority, but there is evident less state media attention to this project. And more importantly, Ministry of Defense not announcing new plans of military build-up in Arctic after completion of current projects in year 2018. It was never easy or cheap to maintain strong military presence in Arctic. Even funding of ongoing projects may be cut if Russia reduces defense spending. The most expensive part of that program, such as formation of motor rifle brigade in Yamal, may be delayed or shelved completely. Because of high current activity, it's easy to overestimate Russian military buildup in Arctic, but it's still pretty limited. There will be only two new light motor rifle brigades at most, one new long-range air defense missile regiment, one fighter regiment, and few new radar and border guard posts on the remote islands. And it's on vast coast, Arctic coast of Russia. Even if second new Arctic brigade in Yamal will be formed, total number of personnel of all new military units will be slightly less than 10,000. Total military presence in Arctic still will be well below a Soviet era levels. Single most important result from current build-up will be much better radar coverage all along northern coast of Russia and better air defense capability of Kola Peninsula. Instead of permanently stationing large forces to defense of Arctic, Russia choose to improve overall force projection capability in the region and use better strategic mobility of reformed army. Air-based renovation and highly mobile and fast reaction airborne troops must allow to quickly beef up military presence if the need arises. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Anton, for a brilliant tour de horizon on the military field. There was nothing I missed there. So, Rebecca, please.
As mentioned, I come from the U.S. Coast Guard. I teach at the Academy, and I'm also at their Center for Arctic Study and Policy, which is a think tank that addresses Coast Guard strategic priorities in the Arctic region from a public policy and political perspective. And so one of the jumping off points that I used to put this talk together was the idea, the phrase that you hear fairly often about good fences making good neighbors in the Arctic, and the U.S. and Russia being good neighbors, right? And I thought that was a fun point. So I went back and looked at the poem that phrase is drawn from, which is obviously a Robert Frost poem that I'm sure you're all familiar with. But it's worth remembering that this poem, despite the way it's often used in sort of contemporary discourse, the poem is a polemic against wall building, right? Something there is that doesn't love a wall. Right, that sends the frozen groundswell under it. But it's interesting, if you look further through that poem, and we are really taking a real 180 from the military buildup, aren't we? We're discussing poetry. But the narrator goes on to say that no walls are needed here because the two neighbors are very, very different. He is all pine and I am apple orchard. There are no cows here that need to be fenced in or out, right? And so I think that's a really interesting thing to think about when we look at the Bering Strait region, which will be the focus of my talk today. There are an increasing number of cows that require cooperative management strategies. And so I'm going to start broadly by discussing the Arctic Coast Guard Forum, and then I'm going to zoom in on that cow management problem, which is the Bering Strait region. I'm going to talk a little bit about what the U.S. Coast Guard is doing and what the U.S. and Russia more broadly need to do to effectively manage the Bering Strait choke point. And then finally, I'm going to talk just very, very briefly about the perhaps unintended impacts of this chatter about militarization and the effect that that's had on U.S. relations with other Arctic nations. I just came back from several months in Iceland, so I got a pretty close-hand look at some of those issues, and there's been some recent developments that I want to flag for you really quickly, but that'll be the last minute or two of my talk. So the Arctic Coast Guard Forum was formally established at the end of October of last year. There was a summit held at my academy, the U.S. Coast Guard Academy in New London, Connecticut. And that meeting, the summit was the formal establishment back in October, but the March before that, the Arctic Coast Guard Forum's experts meeting, which was also held in the U.S., marked the first time that all 8 Coast Guard agencies of the Arctic came together to discuss Coast Guard priorities in the region. And I'm using Coast Guard with a little C here because different Arctic states take different administrative approaches towards fulfilling Coast Guard functions, which we can typically understand as civil security, law enforcement, fisheries enforcement, maritime safety enforcement, search and rescue, emergency response, oil spill pollution. You know, looking at the suite of missions of the U.S. Coast Guard, there's 11 different missions in there, one of which is national defense. So there are a variety, there's a spectrum of things that Coast Guards do, and Arctic states take different approaches towards delegating those authorities. But Coast Guard agencies, which may be housed in ministries of defense or ministries of interior, depending on where they're located, came together to set up the Arctic Coast Guard Forum, which takes a very practical, pragmatic approach towards solving some of the immediate problems that we confront in the Arctic region as the retreat of ice and the increase in human activity generate more need for a government presence to fulfill some of these services. The Arctic Coast Guard Forum, like the Arctic Council, is consensus-based, and it is set up with a rotating chair structure that mirrors the Arctic Council as well. It's on the same schedule. So the U.S. is holding the chair of the Arctic Coast Guard Forum, and we will transfer that to Finland next year. The Arctic Coast Guard Forum is modeled on successful models from other parts of the globe, including the North Pacific Coast Guard Forum. There's also a North Atlantic Coast Guard Forum, so this is not a new model. It's just being applied for the first time to the Arctic region. It is not affiliated with the Arctic Council, and that's something that I do want to underline because there is some confusion. It's not part of the Arctic Council. It is not part of EPPR, but it will be complementary to those efforts, and there's obviously going to be a lot of close coordination. The intention of the Arctic Coast Guard Forum is to leverage collective resources to foster safe, secure, and environmentally responsible maritime activity, which is in the common interest of all Arctic states. The U.S. in particular, as the host of this summit, is committed to combined operations and cooperation in the Arctic region and really points to the Arctic Coast Guard Forum as a tangible demonstration of its commitment to cooperation. The U.S. and Russia were co-chairs of the task force that led to the establishment of the Arctic Coast Guard Forum, and I take that as evidence that Russia is also committed to combined operations in support of shared interests in the Coast Guard sphere in the Arctic region. And the underlying logic is that the Arctic is an area where we're confronted by the tyranny of distance and of extreme conditions. It's hard to do anything up there operationally. The weather is really, really terrible. There are really long distances. Everything in the Arctic, particularly outside of the Nordic region, is about 3 to 5 times more expensive than it is at southern latitudes. And from a governmental perspective, that's very challenging, right? Especially since the increase in human activity is as yet not fully understood. So there's an increasing demand for government services. These government services are very, very expensive, but the demand is increasing at an uncertain tempo, which makes bureaucracy is very uncomfortable. And the idea is collaborating between and among Coast Guards will create more efficient delivery of these government services in common areas of interest. Pivoting now to the Bering Strait region, which is a specific sub-region of the Arctic where the U.S. and Russia are maritime neighbors, the relationship between U.S. and Russia is crystallized and encapsulated and particularly made more important in the Bering region because there is an unavoidable, inescapable boundary in the Bering Strait. Bering Strait is an important and emerging maritime choke point. It's very narrow, 85 kilometers wide, roughly. It's very shallow. It's only about 55 meters deep. It's divided into a couple of different channels by the Diomede Islands, and it is iced over for a significant portion of the year at the moment. It's of enormous ecological significance just right off the bat. It's an area where water flows in and out of the Arctic Ocean from the North Pacific. It's a very important migratory route for marine life, including key marine mammal species that local subsistence communities on both sides of the border depend upon. It's got very unpredictable conditions. The water speed is highly variable, dependent on the weather. And the flow in the Bering Strait is generally northward, but it occasionally can reverse and flow southwards for up to a week. So it's an interesting place where there's been a lot of cross-border scientific research. As you can see, I'm going to flag the Bering Strait Research Project. That's a collaboration between UW, UAF, and the Arctic and Antarctic Research Institute of Russia. There's some very interesting sea dynamics, and the Bering Strait itself is a key part of the overall ocean model of the Arctic Ocean in terms of heat transfer, salinity transfer, the influx of fresh and salt water. So it's a very important area from an environmental and scientific perspective, but it's also of increasing importance as human activity dials up in the Arctic region. Ships will be transiting, are transiting through this choke point. That's a much narrower zone than it is on the far side of the Arctic Ocean, where there's a number of different routes available and there's fewer hazards. So it behooves the U.S. and Russia to take a collaborative approach to managing traffic in this tremendously important ecological zone, and to do it in a way that is cooperative and collaborative, since it's a shared maritime border and a narrow maritime zone. There's I put up a couple of fun pictures here to shake things up a little bit, because the Russians have had to deal with a couple of incursions across the Bering Strait from the U.S. side that have been occasionally unusual, including some guys on jet skis. These are winterized jet skis, and it's a reality show, folks. These are some it's a reality show known as Dangerous Waters, and these guys actually drove across the Bering Strait on souped-up jet skis and ran into the Russian border guard, which pulled the tank up and said, you should leave now. And then, so that's sort of that's one thing to bear. You know, these are sort of the silly examples, but they can be, you know, of importance. On the bottom is a picture of Lynn Cox, who was an American woman who swam across the Bering Strait, not the entire 85 kilometers, obviously, but she swam across the maritime border between the Diomedes, which is about 2.5 kilometers long. And she did this swim in 1986, just a few months before Gorbachev gave his opening of the Arctic speech. And so it's really interesting to think about ways in which some of this stunt traffic might influence international relations. But, you know, back to my main theme here, there's increasing traffic in the Bering Strait region that can be fishing traffic as fish stocks move northwards, a lot of commercial traffic with increases in energy extractive activity, mining activity, possible transpolar shipping activity. There's also visible signs of increased tourist activity. And that's of particular importance from a Coast Guard perspective, given some of the numbers involved. The cruise line Crystal Serenity is planning on taking a ship from Alaska to New York, going up through the Bering Strait this summer, and between passengers and crew, there'll be nearly 2,000 people on board. Not only does that ship carry a lot of oil, which would potentially be spilled if there was some sort of incident, but it also presents a human life rescue question that is currently largely unanswerable. There's a number of really tremendous technical challenges posed by emergency response and search and rescue in the Arctic region, given the lack of infrastructure assets that has already been flagged by a number of speakers. I don't need to go back in there. There are still existing technical problems related to responding to an oil and gas incident. We can't clean oil off of ice yet, and there's not a lot of infrastructure in place to implement response. So the idea of collaborating across the border and taking a team approach to any type of incident is something that, from a Coast Guard perspective, is highly desirable, because it enables us to throw everything at a problem using tools that have already been put in place, communication channels and plans that are being put in place through forums like the Arctic Coast Guard Forum. Some of these key interests, as I've mentioned, response to pollution incidents, which has been, there's been an important first step in that 2013 treaty negotiated under the auspices of the Arctic Council. Hopefully the Arctic Coast Guard Forum can advance that work. Search and rescue, the Coast Guard Forum is an ideal platform for training and exercises relating to search and rescue. It's a good platform for discussing shared approaches to environmental stewardship, and also towards creating the kind of stable regulatory environment that business needs to flourish. And we heard about that before lunch. The critical criteria for business investment in the Arctic region, which is expensive and long range, is a stable regulatory environment with the kind of enabling government activity that sustains other kinds of maritime traffic. So that's effective search and response. It's an effective enforcement of maritime regulations that are coherent. It's an effective interaction with all parts of the maritime commerce field, including the insurance industry, lightering, tugs and barges, port operations, and all of those government functions are typically underpinned or enforced by Coast Guards. So the Arctic Coast Guard Forum is really an ideal means for getting us all Arctic nations, in particular the U.S. and Russia, to a point where we have achieved or made great steps towards achieving these shared goals. In particular, I'll speed up here. The U.S. Coast Guard is in the middle of a PARS, a port access route study process in the Bering Strait region. I'll let you read all that language, but the idea is studying increased maritime traffic and thinking about establishing some rules. For example, areas to be avoided or recommended routes for ship traffic, the idea of developing an electronic atlas to share navigational hazards and updated information on perhaps subsistence uses is something that is discussed. Other kinds of voluntary measures that ships could take, like voluntary speed reduction zones in sensitive areas, is something that's going on with the Coast Guard right now, and I would argue that there's a clear need for the US and Russia to coordinate this approach, to discuss shared approaches for vessel routing. The implementation of the Polar Code, which was just released last year by IMO, needs to be completed by January 1st, 2017. And it would also be useful to the maritime industry if neighboring countries took shared or collaborative approaches to their implementation of the Polar Code. So we've talked about that a little bit with Canada, but on the U.S.-Russian border, it would also be useful to discuss how to implement the Polar Code in a way that is coherent across boundaries that'll support maritime traffic. The needs for weather and ice forecasting are similar across the border, and that is not typically considered sensitive information, so that's a great area where the two states could collaborate on sharing information that'll improve the safety of maritime activity. And then emergency response exercises, which we've talked about a little bit already, but the idea that if there is an emergency, you know who to call. Right, and perhaps you've met your counterparts across the border before, during exercises, you've worked together before, that will improve response outcomes. So I think there's some clear avenues for collaboration in these Coast Guard specific areas which move us towards human and environmental security goals. Finally, my last point, before you wave your piece of paper at me, is on an entirely different tack, and this just feeds off of some time I spent in Iceland recently. The Navy just released its budget request for fiscal year 2017, which includes some upgrades to the former naval base at Keflavik in Iceland. And this is really interesting because there's been fairly strong public opposition to a U.S. military presence in Iceland, and that opposition was heightened with the 2006 pulling out of the U.S. from this base. And so I think there's been sort of an unintended side effect of some of the air patrols and building up that's going on, so-called remilitarization. You know, we've heard some good analyses of that. But it's had this sort of unintended effect of pushing the U.S. closer to some of its Nordic allies. So I think that's something interesting to think about. And this is certainly a timely and very interesting development, but it's not something I want to particularly talk about. I'm here today to plug the Arctic Coast Guard Forum, and I am also out of time. Thank you.
Okay, I think I had a great lunch. I know you all had, but it's great sign that we had some good presentations, that I saw so many wide open eyes listening to these presentations. And indeed, from the context we had given by Lincoln to the excellent outline of the military activities, and especially the emphasis on mobility. As a military analyst, I'm not very concerned about bases, but how good you are at moving things into your area of operations. And finally, Rebecca, that actually shows that cooperation is indeed possible. And doable. So I will now open the floor to questions. And again, please identify yourself. Please identify yourselves. And keep your questions short. I want to give as many as possible the chance to ask questions, and also to see that we don't get too much language barriers here. And speak slowly and clearly. Thank you so much.
Kate. It's so nice to be on this side of the table. Caitlin Antrim, Rule of Law Committee for the Ocean. Anton, I believe, and it gets lost in some of my research, that your organization did a review of the Coast Guard. No?
No.
Well, in any case, do you have anything to address in terms of the Coast Guard function in the Arctic as a seagoing operation in terms of their equipment, their organization, their mission?
No, I don't have a connection with Coast Guard.
Well,
That's an answer
to tell. Yes, gentleman at the back.
Yep.
Jim Dingman, Pacifica Radio. I have some military type questions. First of all, the brigade up there, the 200th Motorized Rifle Brigade, is essentially the ancestor of the rifle division that was up there during the Cold War. And we're just looking at a reorganization of the Russian Army. So I'm just wondering where this comes in a threat analysis. Secondly, these motor rifle brigades, how are they deployed? Are they over like a huge swath of that coastline? I mean, are they deployed in company formations, battalion formations, et cetera? And anyway, like the coastline is so huge, why wouldn't they have a more mobile force up there? And finally, the air bases. You know, that's significant, the redesigning of the air bases. What's the capability of these air bases that are being redesigned? Are they, do they take a regiment? What kind of Russian Air Force type deployments are going on there, and what kind of units are there? And then you mentioned the SA-300s. Are these PMU, SA, are these twos, SA-22s, A's or B's? Because they have longer range. I'm just wondering what's going on.
You said one question.
Yeah, one question. All right, Lincoln, perhaps Anton?
I will answer first questions. Motor rifle brigades Motor rifle brigades was deployed on Arctic islands by big landing ships. Of course, it's not entire brigade. It's only small detachments, about company and levels, and personnel without heavy equipment. Motor rifle brigades, they must protect not only Arctic coast and island, but Kola Peninsula and border areas with Scandinavia. So they must be dual use, motor rifles, line infantry, and light infantry, which are able to operate in Arctic conditions all along coast. Continental airfields will be large private airfields capable to operate any aircrafts, including strategic bombers and heavy transport aircraft. And any such aircraft can be used as a forward operation base and heart of improvised aviation brigade or even division, as we can see in Syria. So it's same size airfields like Latakia airfield.
Yeah, well, I can address the first question as well as the airbase question. You're absolutely right when we're talking about the Arctic brigades. There are three of them up there a lot. These three have been, essentially, they took smaller units and combined them. One is a legacy brigade, so it's been there. I think that's the 80th, the 200th, yeah, for a long time. So we're not actually seeing a huge increase in capability. And where are they located? Well, one's located over by Murmansk. Another one is not too far away. And then this Yamal brigade, I haven't heard about, but if that is stood up, then that's actually going to be out west a little bit. Concerning the air bases, it all depends upon which air bases you're talking about. The ones on the continent, like Tixi, these are large air bases. They take the strategic bombers forward deployed. The smaller air bases on the islands, Novosibirsk, Franz Josef Land, they are over 3,500 feet long, so they can take pretty substantial aircraft. But right now, there are no plans for permanently stationing aircraft there, although there are plans for the MiG high altitude interceptors to be stationed at a few of these bases. I forget which ones. But if that occurs, then that will be the first, in the post-Soviet era, the first redeployment of large air assets to the Arctic. Overall, I agree with your overall assessment. When we look at the Arctic coast, Russia's Arctic coastline, it's enormous. And we're talking about little small dots, okay? And these dots represent maximum 300, 350 deployable forces that could be stationed there. So we're not discussing huge amounts of force structure in the Arctic at this point in time.
Okay. Thank you. Yes, gentlemen here.
Hi, my name is Matthew Bauer from Thomson Reuters Special Services. My question is directed towards Rebecca. Now, I love the idea of cooperation, U.S. Russian cooperation in the Arctic, but in an article from July 6, 2015, Newsweek quotes the Coast Guard Commandant Paul F. Zunknuff, I don't know if I'm saying that right, saying, we're not even in the same league as Russia right now, and we're not in this game at all. So how does the commandant's seemingly negative comment related to U.S. regional capability in the Arctic compared to Russia's support cooperation, meaning that if we are engaging with Russia in the Arctic from a significantly weakened position militarily, how can we expect an atmosphere of equal cooperation to be respected by the Russian Federation into the future?
Thanks for the question. It's pronounced a kunft, just right off the bat. Thank you.
Oh. Microphone. It should be on. It should be on, I think.
Can you hear me now?
Take me off.
No?
Okay.
Thank you. Zukunft is the correct pronunciation, as far as I know. And that quote in specific was referring to the diminished U.S. capacity in icebreakers, specifically. It was not a military assessment in any way. And I think the point that the commandant was making and often makes is that the U.S. should be thinking about acquiring additional icebreakers given the age of our current fleet, which is reduced from where it was several decades ago. So thinking about icebreaker capacity specifically, yes, the U.S. does have a significantly smaller fleet than the Russians, as has already been outlined. And part of that, I think, is natural. Look at the differences in length of coastline. There's a very good reason why the Russians have a large icebreaker fleet that they're continuing to shore up, and it is because they have a massive coastline that they're trying to keep clear as they move forward in developing the NSR, which is a key national priority. So if you look big picture, it makes a lot of sense for the Russians to be constructing and acquiring a strong set of icebreakers. From a U.S. perspective, there are important uses for icebreakers, and we need to ensure that we have a strong and adequate fleet, but we certainly don't need to be building dozens of icebreakers. It's far out of our national interest. So I would say that specific quote was targeting icebreakers in particular, and it's widely acknowledged in the U.S. that we need to find a way to get more icebreakers for the U.S. Coast Guard, but that's been held up for domestic reasons, I would say. Sure. Nuclear icebreakers are great. They can stay out for a really long time. There's some drawbacks with nuclear icebreakers. In particular, there's countries out there that don't want nuclear-powered ships in their ports. And so there's been a clear decision in the U.S. that we didn't build nuclear icebreakers in the 70s. We built diesel ships. They could go into New Zealand. They could go to Australia. They could go through Canada with far fewer questions about the nuclear capacity. And so I think there's a lot of attention paid to nuclear power icebreakers because they're sexy and jazzy, but I think we would get our capacity from traditional diesel plants just fine. And there's also significant environmental questions associated with operating nuclear-powered ships and maintaining and disposing of them that you can avoid by just going diesel-powered.
Okay, yes, the lady here.
Liz Wishnick, Weatherhead East Asian Institute. My question is for Lincoln Flake. You mentioned that Russia has been trying to unlink Arctic issues from broader tensions in the relationship. Could you explain why you think that's the case? And I'd be curious to hear the rest of your recommendations for U.S. policy on that front.
Well, concerning the last point, you'll have to just wait for the article, or we'll be here all day. I have 6 or 7 recommendations that will come out later. If you actually look at many of the Russian official statements, just 2 weeks ago, the Russian representative to the Arctic Council made a statement where he said, we want to de-link as much as possible the Arctic from the wider issues with the West. And he also highlighted the fact that all Arctic strategy papers are made public for transparency. And then again, referring to what I mentioned in my presentation, the fact that in a lot of these strategy papers, like the 2015 National Security Strategy, the Arctic is left out. And this is an extreme, this last one that was released on December 31st by Putin was a very confrontational with aggressive language towards the U.S. and NATO, specifically laying out, suggesting that NATO is creating a national security threat for Russia, yet the Arctic is nowhere to be mentioned there. And I think this goes back to something that was mentioned prior to lunch, and that is Russia looks at the Arctic and it sees these disputes and it sees these economic opportunities and it weighs the pros and cons of its posture in the Arctic. And it basically assesses that it can achieve the most through cooperation, because geography and geology has endowed it in the Arctic with so much natural resources, transportational opportunities, and the fact that most of the energy is in its own EEZ that it needs to develop. There's very little reason for it to fight. And there's only drawbacks for Russia in increasing the geopolitical tension in the Arctic. And I think they make that assessment, and because of that, they're trying as much as possible to disassociate. Now, it's easier for Russia because their foreign policy is based more on interest than principle. Now, the U.S. and NATO, ours is more based on principle, so we like to take a whole of foreign policy approach to an adversary. But Russia, I mean, they can deal with China, they can deal with their enemies in a way that kind of detached, where on one aspect they're cooperating, on the other aspect they're diametrically opposed on issues. So with Russia, I think they're looking to engage and to cooperate despite what's going on in Syria and Ukraine. And that gets to another point, and that is, I think if the U.S. suggests more hard security cooperation, I think they may be surprised at Russia's willingness to go down that road, not just with the Coast Guard forum, but with other forums, maybe expanding the Vienna document verification to include the Arctic. So at this point, a lot of people are thinking that Russia is not very interested in a military code of conduct for the Arctic, but I think if we approach them outside of NATO, because NATO is this big red flag for them, okay, outside of NATO, I think we'd be surprised at Russia's willingness to cooperate and engage in more meaningful, hard security cooperation in the Arctic.
Okay, thank you. And was Kim, a question?
Thank you. Johan, I'm actually going to put you on the spot. One of the topics that got raised in the discussion was military exercises, and I know that you have just completed a major study of Russian military exercises towards the West, where you are concerned about what it might indicate about Russian intentions towards, for example, the Baltics. And I'm wondering if you have any concerns about Russian exercises in the Arctic region.
Oh, thank you. Not concerns as much as observations, and I think Anton's presentation brought that out very clearly, that the Russians can put ground capacity, air capacity, and sea capacity in the Arctic and combine them. When you have this joint inter-service operation, you get much more military output than if you have them separately. And they actually exercise that, especially in the Kola Peninsula as well. So that's, I mean, who else can do joint inter-service operations in the Arctic? General point about exercises, they do reveal a picture of preparations for large-scale war, regional war, i.e. with NATO or China. It's not a small counterinsurgency operation in Central Asia they're exercising for. The size and certain elements of the exercises indicate preparations for larger-scale operations. So much for operations. And now it is Professor Saguni.
I've got a factual clarification to the gentleman question about the Russian Arctic brigades. Actually, we have two brigades which I inherited from the Soviet past. One is motor rifle, but another one is a Marine. So the different subordination before the until recently, and now we the third brigade is under formation in Alakort, while the first two brigades located close to the Russian-Norwegian border in the Murmansk region, nearby the Pechenga and Sputnik settlement. But the third brigade has been formed in Alakort, which is on the Russian-Finnish border, down south of the first two brigades. And as Anton mentioned, there are plans to establish the fourth brigade in Salihard, nearby Salihard, on the Malta Peninsula. But since the mission of this brigade is not clear enough, because Russia does not need defense of coastline by the military means, except there are some plans on the Russian frontier guards to form units to protect from smuggling, from illegal migration, from terrorists or whatever. It's a different plans and a different governmental agency. Those three brigades, they are run by the military, and they have a military missions to protect the Russian western border.
Okay. One small comment on Arctic brigades. Back home, we say an Arctic brigade, it's infantry that knows how to freeze. And if it's any army in the world that knows how to freeze and fight, it's the Russian army. So don't just look at the three so-called Arctic brigades, because 40 minus Celsius degrees is the same in Murmansk as in Novosibirsk. Okay, then it's the lady in red here. Yes. Hold on, wait for the mic.
Rachel Saltzman, Johns Hopkins SAIS. I have actually a follow-up question on Russia's efforts to de-link. I was wondering about the U.S.'s willingness to consider de-linkage and how that plays both publicly and also privately, sort of more behind closed doors. And follow up to that, you mentioned in your answer to the previous question about approaching Russia outside of NATO on more hard security cooperation, and I wondered whether that would cause problems within NATO about feeling about going around the alliance. Thank you.
I don't know, Rebecca, maybe you can take the U.S. decision to de-link. I don't really look at the U.S. very much, I just look at Russia. I suspect that one of my policy recommendations is for the U.S. to disassociate like the Russians have done, and they could actually use the region's unique ecological climate realities as a way of a face-saving way to do this by saying that the realities require a special case, a special status for the Arctic, and therefore we have to engage with the Russians on that level. But about the U.S., I don't know. I think within NATO right now, there's a lot of disagreement over the Arctic. There are some Arctic NATO nations that are not overly enthusiastic about the NATO playing a role in the Arctic. And then there are other non-Arctic NATO nations that are very enthusiastic about it. So because there's internal struggle within NATO right now, I think that may hamper a coherent Arctic policy moving forward. Absolutely, absolutely. Part of the problem is, as was discussed earlier today, in Russia there's a tendency to dual message. To the international community, it's all about peaceful coexistence. Domestically, though, the Arctic has been integrated into their propaganda messaging. And it's, and Dmitry Rogozin, who's in charge of Arctic development, is in charge of this policy of basically scaremongering about Western usurpers, as well as talking about how amazing the Russian Arctic capabilities are. So from the Western perspective, it's very important for us to look and discern Russia's genuine intentions in the Arctic over the nationalist noise that's coming out of their propaganda machine. I think a lot of the times, especially in DC and maybe with some NATO leaders, they just see the outlandish statements coming from Rogozin, and that feeds into this heightened, inflamed, inflated conflict potential that we see in the Arctic in the media and security circles.
Yes, the gentleman here.
Hi there, I'm Hunter Stiers. I'm with Columbia College. This past summer I did some work with the U.S. Naval War College in the Strategy and Policy Department. I'd like to ask you a bit about Russia and anti-Axis area denial, which Dr. Flake, you alluded to in your comments, and Mr. Lavrov, you alluded to in term when you were enumerating Russian capabilities as well as SSBN bastioning. Russia has a long and glorious history of anti-Axis, both in terms of legacy Soviet bastioning of their ballistic missile submarines, and you could say is doing so in the Black Sea. You mentioned that Russia only has one real battery of anti-ship missile
regiment of S-300, yes, on Novosibirskaya, on Nova Zemlya.
Right. As ice continues to melt, how will Russia's priorities shift in anti-access? Right now, it appears more focused on anti-air capabilities rather than anti-surface. And what implications do Dr. Flake and Mr. Lavrov see in terms of implications for continued NATO access to both the Arctic and perhaps the GIUK?
I think very important development is the formation of a second shipborne regiment of fighter aircrafts. It was never such regiments even in Soviet times. So we see that Russia plans to keep their aircraft carriers and keep strong fighters presence of them. And even if ice will melt, aircraft carriers will be very very good assets in protection cost, best assets. And of course, there is a new modernization of what of air bases, continental air bases, where fighters can be temporarily or permanently stationed. So we have continental airfields and possibly aircraft carrier to defend in future when ice will melt.
Yeah, this is an excellent question. I think it goes right into the last session that we're going to talk about threats. Nothing keeps me up at night, but if something was to keep me up at night concerning Arctic security, it's this idea of Russia's maritime claims that stretch back 100 years. And it's somewhat ambiguous. Right now we know that they believe that the straits along these archipelagos are internal waters. The U.S. has a policy of saying, no, they're not internal waters, okay? But even beyond that, as I mentioned in my talk, there's this special article in UNCLOS, the ice-covered article, which basically says, in where there's ice present, the border state can exercise extra-jurisdictional control over surface traffic within its EEZ. Normally, it's only up to 24 miles. This is 200 nautical miles. And in several of the legislative moves concerning the NSR in recent years, they've alluded to this article. Okay, and the fear here is, well, you can understand from a commercial perspective, Russia wants to capitalize as much financially on the ice melting and ships going through there with icebreaker fees, administrative costs, and other issues related to that. But there's also the military aspect, and that is NATO-US warships going into Russia's EEZ. Now, in August and September, there's no ice there, practically. Okay, what would happen if next September the U.S. decides to do a freedom of navigation, not through the straits, but just through the Caracalla and that area, within Russia's EEZ? How would Russia react? Some people may think they wouldn't react at all. I tend to believe they would react. They would cite this UNCLOS article saying, no, you cannot bring your ships in here. And you can go back all the way to the 1960s. That's the last time we tried that, was with Coast Guard ships in the 1960s, and the Soviet Union had a complete fit over it. I know you're going to talk about this. I think we disagree on this subject a little bit, but it's certainly an issue that needs to be discussed and needs to be planned for on the U.S. side, because a lot of Russian scholars, and again in these legislative bodies, they've really hit on this Arctic sector policy, that this is our sector. Military activity, U.S., you can do it in your sector, but don't come in our sector, or we're going to react harshly.
Okay, thank you. I have three names on the list now. It's Austin, gentleman there, and Caitlin. Short questions, please, because we are approaching the very end of our session.
Thanks, Austin Long, Columbia University. So it's clear that Russia makes different statements to the international and domestic audiences, but I think the implication of at least one of Dr. Flake's comments was it's the domestic that's noise and the international that's signal. How do we know that's actually the case?
That's for me. It's an assessment. Well, with the domestic messaging, it's just talk. When it comes to the international audience, we've actually seen agreements, the 2008 agreement, the Arctic agreement, the oil spill agreement, the search and rescue agreement. We've seen cooperation when it comes to the continental shelf delineation. We've seen the 2010 Norway-Russia maritime demarcation agreement. We've seen the Coast Guard. There have been steps, circumpolar cooperation, in the last 5 or 6 years that backs this idea that to the international community, Russia is seeking to downplay the risk of conflict.
And I would also suggest looking at Russia's core interests in the Arctic region, which are primarily of an economic nature, and that's been underlined repeatedly today and in many other venues. Business wants a stable, predictable, and secure operating environment. The majors are not going to sink millions of dollars into infrastructure if they're concerned about the threat of armed conflict. And so I think from all of the talks that we've heard today about the place of the Arctic in Russia's economic plans for the future, that underscores that a lot of this hardening is either aimed at a domestic audience or predicated on the idea that to effectively nurture a functioning business environment, awareness, maritime domain awareness, improved communications, and the ability to respond and to enforce government presence is the true intent. That would be my take on it.
Okay, thank you. Yes.
Hi again, Matthew Bauer, Thompson Reuters Special Services. This question is related to anybody who wants to answer it. But we talk about a lot about the Arctic Council. So there's no doubt the Arctic Council is the most significant, influential neoliberal institution geared towards Arctic governance. But the introduction of military infrastructure and Arctic combat brigades into the high north kind of pose a legal challenge to the Arctic Council, because the Ottawa Declaration, its founding document in 1996, says, and I quote, "The Arctic Council should not deal with matters related to military security." Now, how can we expect the Arctic Council to facilitate, cooperation or address a higher security posture in the high north if by statute it's not even designated to do so?
I don't think anyone's suggesting that the Arctic Council should start engaging on security matters. I think that would be extremely unpopular. And this sort of echoes the question earlier about delinking. I think thinking about the smaller scale issues where we can all find common agreement and cooperation, those are typically in the core areas of the Arctic Council: environmental protection, sustainable development. Even the Arctic Coast Guard Forum, which does not have that ban on security affairs and which includes some security actors because some nations house their coast guards within their navies. Even that forum is really focused on practical problems and softer definitions of security because oil spilled in the water does not recognize maritime boundaries, right? If a cruise ship sinks in the Arctic region, whoever's closest is going to respond. And so these are the sort of tangible, immediate concerns, the likelihood of an oil release or a large emergency response involving human lives. Those are the things that are very likely to happen anytime soon, right? Because that activity is going up right now. And so I think that cooperation and those sorts of immediate pressing concerns, which don't have all the that don't send alarm bells ringing in the way that military issues do, is a much more promising avenue for cooperation and discussion that may give us leads into the more thornier problems of military security. But the Arctic Council, I haven't seen anything indicating that it wants to tackle anything national security based. I don't know if any of you have.
Okay, I think we go into the final question. We have to wrap up within a few minutes.
I just can't leave this uncorrected. Article 234 is in the environmental part of the Law of the Sea Convention. Article 236 says, in the same section, says, the provisions of this convention regarding the protection and preservation of the marine environment do not apply to any warship, naval auxiliary, other vessel or aircraft owned or operated by a state and used for the time being only on government non-commercial service. So, I mean, the U.S. wrote this article with Canada, so we really did cover our bases there. That said, environmental provisions are not yet well developed in the Polar Code, but that can be addressed in that. The Polar Code is a start right now, not the end. So do you think that we could address the intent of these provisions while defending to whatever challenge we need to that warship passage provision?
Good question. I just know from the Russian point of view, maybe not from the official Russian point of view, but from academia and other circles, that this Article 234 is a big question mark. So what you presented was the U.S. side. The Russian side, they have a different perspective on that. The Russians have been able to argue with it. But regardless, I think it's an issue that we need to study. And absolutely, the Russians would certainly disagree with our interpretation of that UNCLOS article.
Okay, thank you very much. I think we give a hand to the panel.